Okay, but it is done in a political scene, which today is not, you know, exactly conducive to what we want to do. But I think that the simple point is just do what is in your best interest to do. And if you can stick to that, I think we can make a big change in the way others approach the project problem with us.
Vivek. Morning, sir. You were talking about the subsidies getting removed in diesel, petrol and all, and this will lead to a change in paradigm, the way people look at it. But are there any major projects in the pipeline by government or by companies like you, I mean, which will offset this subsidy? Because once you start, and the process you said has already started, so what are the alternative things which we have in hand right now? What are the major projects?
I think the most important point is efficiency. What you will find is that you're probably aware of it, that since the last year or so, we have a labeling program on home appliances. So refrigerators, air conditioners, other home appliances are all having a five-star label program. Now this labeling program is all about efficiency, and it's going to be tightened every 3 years. So the saving that you get from improved efficiency itself pays for, you know, the reduction in demand, also pays for with a lower cost of investment, because you have to invest less even with higher demand. So that's one way that you save. The other way is to bring in other efficiency factors, say in the transport industry. Today you see the growth of personal transport, two-wheelers, cars, etc. Okay. Actually, the unfortunate part is we are not seeing the paradigm change in public transport. The public transport, which is buses, metros, bus rapid systems, you know, all types of other public transport, which caters to every income level. So you can't have public transport which only caters to very poor people. It must cater to everyone. That's the only time that you're going to leave your car behind and take a public transport. Today, if you live in New York or London, the chances are that you will not own a car, because there is a good alternative. Actually, both London, New York and Tokyo as a city are very, very efficient cities. If you see the amount of energy that they consume per person, you'd be surprised to know that it's actually less than, say, Bombay, Delhi or Madras. So there is a paradigm change that will be required. And all this, the whole economics of transport, energy use, etc. has to change. That's only how this whole subsidy regime will have to change.
Hello sir, my name is Vasijit. My question is, what can and what should India do to be ahead of China in the manufacturing sector?
That's a, you know, it's, we need plenty of time to discuss that. But in a simple way, if you see the terms of trade that have been there in China, what have they done? They've invested in infrastructure very heavily. So basically, there are no shortages of electricity. Transport is very fast and very inexpensive. Airports, ports, shipping. So the whole infrastructure that's required to support manufacturing is in place. Secondly, the government has an explicit policy of supporting most of the companies in China are state-owned. And they have this explicit idea of supporting them with cash, irrespective of when that cash is actually paid back. So there are many, many aspects of in China which which have allowed this to happen. The third thing is scale. If you see the scale of manufacture in China, it's enormous, it's mind-boggling. Okay. In any product that you can talk about between India and China, it could be 10 times, 20 times, 50 times difference. So scale itself brings a huge amount. Third thing is a disciplined workforce. Okay. In a communist control system, you know, you're not going to have indiscipline and lack of productivity. Despite that, you are reading today about stoppages of work in some of the foreign car companies like Honda and others. Okay. So it's a completely different method of doing. Our only best, the best thing that we have for us is the ability to think. Innovation is what is going to make that difference. I think our ability to think differently and express ourselves differently, I think the very fact that the diversity that we have of people, diversity of minds, I think that is our greatest strength. So how do you actually harness that for manufacturing? That is the crucial part. And product innovation is going to become the keystone for that. Today there are many, many technically oriented products that we have, which do extremely well against China. But they don't have the scale. Most of them are very good products, but they don't have the scale, so they don't have the cost structure. So I think we have to harness the really intelligent and wonderful minds that we have, like all of you do, in manufacturing. Now this is a challenge for the manufacturing industry to attract like people like you to come into manufacturing. It is a challenge. But that is part of the process.
I would like to answer a little more on that. Jamshed had the leadership and vision to create the manufacturing summit, and I had four times keynote speech in that. One time, which I came from Chicago, I have published an article where the article's title is Dragon versus Elephant, and it is like a tennis match. All right, advantage dragon, advantage elephant, deuce. There are three zones. All right, there are certain aspects of manufacturing where if the material costs are more than 35%, the skill level is significant, etc., etc. Yes, a group of items. If that is the case today and ever, India will dominate, China cannot even come close. On the contrary, we talk about the scale. If it is a billion, huge size, whereas I am talking about small custom job shop type. If it is a large process oriented, scale oriented kind of stuff, and there are sort of kind of conditions where the labor is not needed, automation is needed, etc., etc. Advantage to China and not to India. We will never even come close no matter what we do. We can try. And then there's a whole range of area where it is an open level playing field. So my purpose of that article was to appeal to the government and policy makers to identify the region of the deuce area and create incentives and subsidies such that the deuce become advantage in India. I will make sure in less than 1 week that article will be in all your hands. Thank you.
So new eco-friendly building mandate is going to come up. Generally these buildings are 1.5 to 1.7 times costly to the normal building of the same structures. So how's government going to play a role in it, and the corporate house like you going to play a role in it to keep a check on the real estate price?
You know, real estate is, I think, the cost of real estate is in some ways devoid of reality. So it's very difficult to, in a city like Bombay, which is constrained because of the sea all around it, it was the nexus between builders, politicians, and bureaucrats that conspired to keep the availability of land low, and because the demand was so high, the price just went up. Today, prices of flats in Bombay, in good areas, are more than in London and New York. So, what is the reality in that? There is none. So, I think the point really is about land use policy. I think you've got to understand that if you want affordable housing, the land use is the most crucial part of it. Building costs, you know, between the lowest cost of building and the highest cost of building isn't going to vary a lot. It's the interior finishes and that really makes the difference in the cost of construction.